just long and you go numb.
Hello! Welcome to church. We are here in the baptism. It is becoming a normal spot to start the service, and it's still our favorite spot to start a service. For those of you that were not able to attend last evening, we finished off last night's evangelism conference with a profession of faith, which was awesome. Miss Robin Duke came forward last night, and she wanted to publicly profess that with her words. And then today, she wanted to follow in believer's baptism and profess that through her act of baptism. So Robin Duke's been coming for a few months to church. We've baptized just about the entire family. Now, which is awesome. That's right. Yeah. My little minion Daniel, he's next, but we're working on him. But anyway, Robin wanted to come and get baptized today. What is baptism? It's an act. It's a physical act expressing what is inside of you. It's expressing your faith through a physical act, and it shows that we are dying to self like Jesus died on the cross for our sins, and we are being raised to new life like Jesus was resurrected on the third day. It's a phenomenal, awesome, wonderful thing to celebrate together. So, Robin, if you want to come down and jump in this freezing cold water. I lied to her last night. I told her we'd get it warm, but I got it warmer than it was when we started.
Okay.
Woo, atta girl. All right. Robin, is it true that you have repented of your sins and placed your faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
All right. By your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in his likeness, and raised to newness of life. Yeah! Awesome. Wayne Crawford is going to come up and lead us in our time of prayer, and then we'll get into worship through song.
Good morning. Is this thing on? Okay. Well, if you missed last night, you missed a huge blessing. A few weeks ago, I got a text on my phone, and it was from my wife. And she had sent two songs she downloaded on my phone. She said, I want you to sing these with us at the conference. And I thought, she sent this to the wrong person. I'm not even going to respond to this. And then at the end of the text, she said, and yes, I meant to send this to you. Ha. I thought, she's nuts, gone nuts, just sending junk out. But overwhelmingly last night, though, I heard several people comment that they were out of their comfort zone, and I definitely was myself, but not like some of y'all were. But, you know, you think about what is your comfort zone, and I don't know what mine is. I can't describe it. Nobody else can either, but, you know, God is asking us, get out of that comfort zone and get out there and serve. You know, I learned a few things last night, and for one was Austin Foster has one incredible voice and needs to be up here doing that more often because that was very, very good. And I also learned in Sunday school this morning, if you wait too long and you don't receive all your crowns, you're only going to show up with one wing and a cardboard box. It was a good conference, and the overwhelming question that was asked last night to me is, do you just want to sit around and listen to stories about Jesus Christ, or do you want to get up and live with him? That's what it comes down to. Do you just want to sit there, or you want to get up and live with him? Because he is alive. He is here right now. So he asked me to lead us in prayer, so let's pray. Jesus Christ, I just ask you to say, thank you for allowing us to be here last night and be here today, and for the lives you have given us, and for the opportunities that we do have in our lives to serve you. I just pray that we always have these things that we can do for you, that you give us these ideas to try and further your word. I pray for this church that it becomes a light in this community you want it to be. I pray for the families that are here that we would live our lives in according to your word. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Good morning. Well, before we get going, I want to kind of piggyback off some things that were just said. It is so true that we have some amazing opportunities to serve here. And I think one of the coolest things that I heard Scott say last night was that Christ doesn't care about our ability, but about our availability. And so I see a lot of available people right here, right now. And I just am going to give you some opportunities now that you can serve. So one of those being right up here with us. All right, last night, as Wayne pointed out, we had a stage full of people that were just worshiping. And at the end of the, if you were here last night, I don't know if you noticed that there was a change, I would say, in the temperature of the atmosphere, the worship atmosphere, when the stage filled up with people. And I can tell you the reason that is. We know that we walk strong in Christ, but we still are humans. And in our humanity, we find strength in numbers, right? So when the more people we gather around us, the stronger and more confident we are to do the things that are inside of us that fear will suppress. And as soon as everybody felt like they were a part of a group and not more of an individual, everybody started worshiping so freely. And it did. It changed. We went from being just one big thermometer of a room to a thermostat that changed the entire temperature of worship. And as soon as we started worshiping, then everyone out there felt free to worship. So I'm saying all of that as an invitation. We've got plenty of room up here, and we would love to have any and everybody join us. Heck, if we need to all get up here on stage, so be it, all right? But you have an open invitation to come join us. It's a very minimal commitment. You just have to be here on Sunday morning, really, is what it boils down to. And so if you're already here, well, you've accomplished what you need to. You just need to walk from there to be up here. And I'll go ahead, and if you want to make your way up here, feel free to. Another thing, we've had a brand new opportunity for someone to serve in, however many people. I don't know if you've noticed, but we've got some new lights. The lights that we decided in December that we were going to have installed, that happened this week. So those are up and running and operational, but that created a space for somebody, if you don't mind sitting up there between a couple of old guys. Now he's going to cut my mic off. But if you want to serve, but you don't want to serve up here, you'd rather be behind the scenes, now we have a perfect opportunity in operating the lights. It can be a fantastic ministry, and I'm learning how to do it, so I invite anybody that wants to, youth, it doesn't matter. It's a pretty simple operation, and I'd love to have somebody come and learn alongside me, and then that will just increase how we're able to use these new lights. So there's a couple opportunities out there. Pray about those things, and you can just come and find me if you have any questions about any of that. All right.
Starry host, you traced the mountain peaks, you paint the evening skies with wonder. The earth, it is your throne, from desert to the sea, nature testifies your splendor. Everything that has breath, praise the Lord. twisted burning stars, all creatures near and far, from sky to sea to shore, sing out forevermore. Let everything that has breath praise the
I'm
Thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy, for your love. Lord, we thank you for all of the things that you are. You're perfect and holy, and how blessed we are to have you, to be able to draw upon, to seek, to call your name out, and know that you're just a heartbeat away. We don't even have to have the words to say. You know our every thought. You know the ponderings of our heart. And so, Lord, I just ask that as we prepare ourselves to hear your word, Lord, that you would refocus our minds. Focus us on things of you, Lord, so that those innermost pieces of who we are, Lord, that they represent you as much as anything that we can do on the outside. Lord, we long to be your hands and your feet. And I'm so grateful to be in a church, be a part of a congregation that takes that serious. Lord, if you have something that you are calling an individual here to this morning, I just pray that you use all of the events of this weekend to just solidify that you have a greater purpose than us just living. We need to live for you. And let us step out boldly in faith to carry out the callings on our lives, Lord. Lord, we praise you and we love you. And we thank you for Jesus. And it is in his holy name that we pray. Amen. You may be
seated. Amen. Please have a seat as the worship team is making their way back to their seats. And before we dig in this morning, I do want to take just a second to give a really, really big thank you to a lot of people, but mainly to one person. As Josh already said, we had the lights installed this week. The pros that came and did that for us were great, but the prep before what they did and the things after was a lot of work, and we had a lot of people help. Mr. Wayman and Mr. Todd helped supervise and keep us out of trouble, and Dusty and Stuart came and helped and did a lot, and Doug did a lot. We had to move pews and things like that, but I really want to take just a second to really thank Josh and Kelly, for that matter. Josh worked his tail end off this week and did a lot to get it ready for those guys to work. As you can imagine, last week was not a great week for me, and so I was a little bit scarce, and Josh took care of it himself. So I just wanted to tell you thanks, Josh. I appreciate it. It means a lot. All right, we are still in our series. Mr. Land, I'm sorry, we're still in our series on the Sermon on the Mount. I mean, it's three chapters, it's a lot. But we're at the worship of the kingdom servants today. The worship of the kingdom servants. We'll start in Matthew chapter 6, verse 1. And we've looked at so far the character of a kingdom servant, the job of a kingdom servant, the righteousness of a kingdom servant. Last week we looked at the standards for a kingdom servant. And today we're looking at the worship, the proper, authentic, genuine worship of a servant of the King of Kings. The first week, real quick, we looked at that Jesus tells us how to be happy, satisfied, and fortunate are those who have the correct heart towards their sin, their Lord Jesus, and towards the world. Nothing shakes them. Then we looked at the job of the kingdom servant, which is to bring the God flavors and the God colors out of the world, to bring his kingdom to the world, to bring heaven to earth. And by doing that, we make people open up to the idea that God loves them, cares for them, and wants to save them and have a relationship with them. And then we looked at the righteousness of a kingdom servant. Jesus has fulfilled the law of righteousness. The ceremonial law, the sacrificial blood law has been fulfilled in Jesus. And he expects that by faith that we live up to the law's high standard, which is loving God by loving each other, honoring God by honoring and loving and helping each other. And then last week we looked at, and it was a lot, and I feel like we really didn't drive this home, so I want to make sure we get this today. When you can be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect, then and only then can you judge who is righteous and unrighteous. And we know that we can't be, we are not perfect. That's the whole point of the entire thing. That the standard is perfection, but perfection is unobtainable. So the actual standard is just a surrendered heart. That's what God's calling us for, a surrendered heart. Another way Josh said this morning was to be available to God for what he wants to do in our lives. And we finished off with this statement: holy, sanctified, complete maturity is the standard for a kingdom servant. You have to be surrendered to God. And only with a repentant, born-again, transformed heart, God makes you new, is it even possible to even do the good works that God has put before us before time began. So that's where we are with all that. And then today we're digging in to the worship of a kingdom servant. So, love it. sorry. as we get into that, anybody in here a baseball card collector? Anybody in here like to collect baseball cards? Got a few? Okay. I used to when I was younger. I never got any good ones. I've still got my mom still has a few buckets of them at my house. I looked through them a couple years ago hoping I'd find, one that was like worth a bazillion dollars, but I didn't. But baseball cards, that through the years, they've retained their value. They're still cool. They were cool when I was 8 and I got a stick of gum with it, which was the coolest part then, and they're still cool now. They kind of have the history of the game and things like that. And there's things that make baseball cards valuable, okay? One of the major things is who the baseball card is of. Who is the player on the card, right? If it's Joe Blow, the terrible hitter, nobody cares about his baseball card. Right, but if it's tied to some history, or if the player was really good, or if there's a good story about the card, that can really increase the value of the card. It depending on the condition of the card, right? The actual physical card. How are the edges? How is the coloring? How faded is it? How pristine is its condition, right? So the top three most valuable baseball cards currently, all right? Starting with three, going to one. The third one, most valuable, is Babe Ruth, okay? Babe Ruth, if you don't know, is the great Bambino, the Sultan of SWAT, the Colossus of Clout, or the Babe. If you've ever watched The Sandlot, you at least know that. He was the first global star, right? He was the first one. He made six-figure salaries when he played in the 20s and 30s, which was unheard of. He was the first one to really be an international superstar for baseball. And he was on the all-century team, right? And you know that he had the home run record for a long time. It was eventually broken by Hank Aaron and then again by Barry Bonds, although he did it without the things Barry Bonds did it with. Anyway, this iconic card specifically is the one that is so valuable. It's a 1933 Goudet number 53, and it sold in July of 21 for $4.2 million. The second most valuable baseball card currently is of Mickey Mantle, right? Mickey Mantle played for the Yankees, had a great career. He was injury-riddled. If he hadn't been injury-riddled, there's no telling the numbers he would have set. Regarded as the best switch hitter in the history of the major leagues, right? He finished his career with 536 home runs. I have a saying of his that I keep in my office. It says, I was once asked if I ever tried to hit a home run when I was going up to bat, and he said, sure, every time. I love that mentality. Go for it, right? Go for the home run. The iconic card, this one right here, 1952 Topps number 311. It sold for $5.2 million in 2021. And the most famous card, or the most valuable card, excuse me, currently in the baseball card history. Anybody know who it is? Attaboy. Honus Wagner, okay? He's a shortstop way back in the day. So if you're just a casual baseball fan, you probably had no idea that that was coming. He was known as the Flying Dutchman. He had 3,420 hits and 723 stolen bases. He was like the guy in baseball, the standard, until Babe Ruth came along. The card here that is on the screen is the 1911 American Tobacco Company T206, which sold for $6.6 million in August of 21. And he was also part of the original Baseball Hall of Fame class, which is how I found out who he was when I went through the Baseball Hall of Fame 10 or 11 years ago. What's the point of all this? Here's the point. The card has to be pristine. It has to be someone that matters on the card. There's a whole lot of things that go into making the card valuable. But the number one thing that makes a baseball card valuable is it actually has to be an authentic card. It can't be a reprint. It can't be counterfeit. If it's not an actual, authentic, sincere, genuine baseball card of that actual marking from that actual company and all those things, then the fact that it's in great condition and it's of Honus Wagner and it's all those other things, if it's not an authentic card, it doesn't matter. It has no value to anyone that wants to collect it. As we get into our worship this morning, that definitely ties in to how Jesus views our worship, the authenticity of it. Starting in verse 48 of chapter 5, because it ties in with where we're starting today, let's read together. Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Be careful not to practice your righteousness. This is how to be perfect. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of the people to be seen by them. Otherwise, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give to the poor, don't sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be applauded by people. I assure you, they've got their reward. But when you give to the poor, don't let your hand know what your right hand is doing. Your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Whenever you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, because they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by people. I assure you, they've got their reward. When you pray, go into your private room, shut your door, and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you pray, don't babble like the idolaters, since they imagine they'll be heard for their many words. Don't be like them, because your Father knows the things you need before you ask Him. Therefore, you should pray like this: Our Father in heaven, Your name be honored as holy. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For if you forgive people their wrongdoing, your heavenly Father will forgive you as well. But if you don't forgive people, your Father will not forgive your wrongdoing. Whenever you fast, don't be sad like the hypocrites, for they make their faces unattractive, so their fasting is obvious to people. I assure you, they've got their reward. Last couple of verses. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that you don't show your fasting to people, but to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Okay? Three common acts of worship, Jesus defines what is proper and what is not. Three things really that the Pharisees kind of had elevated to how to be super God follower, right? These things specifically, you were definitely showing your righteousness. You were definitely a righteous person. If you were an alms giver, right? This isn't a sacrifice to the temple. This isn't a tithe to the temple. This is almsgiving. This is way up and above. This is just giving to the needy. That's what the word means. It literally means acts of mercy, but it had become to be synonymous with giving to the needy, giving to someone that needs help, right? And so if you're giving to the needy, then you're definitely righteous, right? And if I'm standing up here praying, then I'm definitely righteous, right? And so Jesus picks these three things specifically because he's hitting at the self-righteousness and the things he despised about the Pharisees. And that's what we're digging into today. And so the thesis for this section, these three things, is the statement there in the first verse. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of people to be seen by them. Otherwise, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. Okay? We Scott said this last night, and I had already read it in the commentary before he said that, and it's funny how things like that work out. We default to works righteousness. That's who we are. We default to that. We want to do good and be seen doing good and be justified by that fact. And Jesus is saying, be careful with that mindset. Be careful with that mindset. It is wrong. It is not authentic. It is not what I desire. It's not what God the Father desires. But this is kind of this statement right here is the point of the three things that he goes into. And understand this as we get into these. It's not the act itself that is wrong. The same act can be right or wrong, depending on the why behind the act. It's the why behind the act. It's the heart behind the act. It's the desire of the act, right? So Jesus chooses three normal acts of worship that the Pharisees had risen up to be, how to be a super worshiper of God. And he gets right smack dab to the heart of it. And he starts with, so whenever you give to the poor. So whenever you give to the poor. Notice what's not in that statement. So if you give to the poor. He didn't say that. He didn't say, if you give to those who need. He says, so whenever you do. It's an expectation. The acts of mercy, the almsgiving, the giving to the needy, the pitching in and making life go when you've been blessed a little more financially than others, that's part of it, Jesus says right off the bat without having to say it. He says, when you do that, don't do it like those people over there. Don't do it like the Pharisees and the scribes. Don't do it like the hypocrites. Hypocrites, in Jesus' vernacular, it starts here, but it becomes just the common term for the Pharisees and the scribes. Right? That's just how he refers to them pretty much from here on out, which I think is hilarious, but that's neither here nor there. Don't sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be applauded by people. We've talked about before, he's not literally saying this, but it's kind of an allusion to the temple boxes where you gave your money, where you gave your offering, right? And when you did that, it was a trumpet-looking thing that came out of the box, and when you threw that into the box, it would clang and it would make noise, right? And so the harder you threw it and the more you threw in there, the louder and more recognizable it would be, right? The equivalent to today, hand me your phone, Dad. The equivalent today is this right here. Right now, it's the heart behind it, because sometimes the heart behind this is right, but it's like you pull out the $100 bill and you're like, right? Same thing today. I'll hold this up here so you can focus. All right. Right? You take out a $20 bill and you hand it to the person, right? Or you give it to the person, and if nobody sees it, it's almost like, well, man, that really wasn't even worth it, was it? Well, hashtag sold out for Jesus, right? Or whatever we do. And we've all done it, right? And sometimes we're doing those things with the right motive. Oftentimes we're not. Oftentimes what we're doing is patronizing and demeaning the person that we're trying to help. At their expense, we're feeling good about ourselves, and that's not what Jesus is calling us to do. He says, so don't do that, right? What is your heart? What is your motive? What are you trying to accomplish by your almsgiving, by your giving to the needy, right? So, in other words, the motive, the heart, determines the result. That's what Jesus is concerned about. When you do it so that you can be seen, you get the glory. Man, did you see what so-and-so, how much they gave? That is so cool. That is awesome. You get the praise. You get the glory. But when we do it with the right motive, someone sees through the same exact act as a way and a reason to praise God for what He has done. What is the motive? Your motive, your heart behind it determines the result. Right? So the thing here, the concern, is the tendency for us to compete with God's glory. That's what works righteousness is. Okay? And works righteousness doesn't exist. We think it does, but when we try to do good so that we think we are good, we're competing with God for His glory, and God won't stand for that. He just won't stand for it because we don't deserve that. Only He does, the Creator, right? So, in other words, help people, not your ego. Don't help your ego. Help people when they need to be helped, but don't help your ego. Isaiah says it like this. If you go back to the Old Testament prophet Isaiah, he says, the Lord said, because these people approach me with their mouth and honor me with lip service, yet their hearts are far from me, and their worship consists of man-made rules learned by rote. Right? Paul tells us in Romans chapter 10, verse 10, that the person believes with the heart, and that results in righteousness, not the acts, not the good works. Catch this, Jesus follower. Ephesians 2:10 says that Jesus created those works before you were even born. The good works you think you're doing for your own sake to make you good and righteous, you couldn't even have done them if God hadn't planned it in the first place. It's such a waste of time for us to try to live up to righteousness by our own works. But the same act can have a great result when it's done for the right reason with the right heart. And he says, these people, right, they got their reward. I assure you, he says, I assure you they've got their reward. Amen and amen, right? I assure you, I tell you the truth. 32 times Matthew uses that statement. I assure you, I tell you the truth. What would that happen? What would you do if you were listening to Jesus and he says, I assure you. You'd listen, right? Your ears would perk up. That's why he does that. I assure you. They've got their reward. He's preparing their ear to hear something important. They're going to get what they're going to get, and that's it. That's all they're going to get. They're not going to get anything that they want. So where's another example of this happening, right? Let's check this out. Acts chapter 5, okay? The result of giving to impress people instead of being sincere before the Lord. But a man named Ananias, with his wife Sapphira, sold a piece of property. However, he kept back part of the proceeds with his wife's knowledge and brought a portion of it and laid it at the apostles' feet. Then Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and keep back part of the proceeds of the field? Wasn't it yours while you possessed it? And after it was sold, wasn't it at your disposal? Why is it that you plan this thing in your heart? You have not lied to men, but to God. Catch that. You have not lied to men, but to God. When he heard these words, Ananias dropped dead, and a great fear came on all who heard. The young men got up, wrapped his body, carried him out, and buried him. This is Acts chapter 5, for those taking notes. There was an interval of about 3 hours. Then his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. Tell me, Peter asked her, did you sell the field for this price? Yes, she said, for that price. Then Peter said to her, Why did you agree to test the Spirit of the Lord? Look, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out. Instantly, she dropped dead at his feet when the young men came in. They found her dead, carried her out, and buried her beside her husband. Then great fear came on the whole church and all who heard these things. What is the point? The point is that they tried to act like they were giving everything that they had earned from that property sale. It's not that they didn't give everything. God didn't call them to do that. He didn't ask them to do that. What he asked them to do was be sincere. If they sold it for $100, but they're only giving 50, or they're only giving 10, or they're giving 75, or whatever it is, just be real about it, right? But that's not what they're doing. They're not doing something to honor God. They're doing something so they get honored. They wanted to look special. They wanted to look like they were super, super generous people, right? So they sold the property for $100, but they give 50, and then Peter says, was that the sale price? Is that how much you sold the property for? Yep, sure was. And God says, poof, right? Whew, that's kind of scary. What if we started like having an offering plate right here, and when you walked by and gave your offering, I'm like, is that a tithe? Are you sure that's a tithe? Is that actually 10%? I mean, if it is or if it isn't, it doesn't matter. But if I asked you and you said right here before in front of everybody it was, but it wasn't, it's the exact same thing they're doing. What's the point? The point is God absolutely despises appearances that are not reality. He despises that. That's what hypocrisy is. It's pretending to be something you're not. If you're not giving the entire price of the property, just say you're not. I mean, think about it. If you sold the property for $100 and you gave 10 or 20 bucks out of that to the church, to the needy, to whoever, that's still awesome. It's not the amount. It's the fact that you give, even at all, is a good thing. Just be real about it. Be honest. Right? Don't be like the hypocrites, Jesus is saying. But when you give to the poor, don't be like them, but Jesus says, but you, when you give to the poor, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. It's an emphatic you, like you would have caught that if you were hearing it said, and Jesus said it. That emphasis on the you would have been like, okay, that's how the hypocrites are doing it, the Pharisees and the scribes. But you, my kingdom servants, my followers, my disciples, my people, you have to be different than that. You have to worship authentically, my kingdom servants, right? Who's he talking to? Remember, I know we've been in this so long, we forget. Chapter 5, the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, right? The crowds were around, but then Jesus sat down and his disciples drew near. He's teaching his disciples, his true followers, his servants, right? And when he says here about they'll receive their reward, but your Father will reward you. The way the language kind of says it, it's like the hypocrites are getting their wage. They're getting what they deserve, okay? As opposed to what God is going to reward. So the idea here is this repayment. Like if you do it for man's approval, you'll get man's approval, and it'll be equal basically to what you've done, and that's pretty much all you're going to get. But when you do it with the right heart, with the right motive, and you get God's reward, you get God's disproportionate grace. He gives way more back than we could ever give to him. He's saying, so choose for yourself. Choose which way you want to be rewarded. You want to be rewarded by man, or you want to be rewarded by God? God judges the heart. Man judges the outside. In other words, do all you can to avoid drawing attention to yourself. Do everything you can to draw attention to the Lord. But do all that you can to not draw attention to yourself. I like it the way the Holman commentary says it. It says, the gift from the heart is given out of love for the Father, and the reward is returned as to a dearly beloved son. Anything we do for each other should be done for the Father. Yes, it benefits you, or when you do something to me, it benefits me, but it should be done out of love for the Father, trusting that the Father is going to give back to his dearly beloved son, just like a good earthly father does the exact same thing for his kids. Then he moves on. He says, whenever you pray, first is giving, second is prayer. Now, when you pray, notice it doesn't say if you pray, it says whenever you pray. Now, we talked in depth about this in our Talking to Jesus series back in late August, early September, so we're not going to hit this real deep. If you want to hit this real deep, go back to that series. It's on the website, and we get deep into the disciples' prayer and all those types of things. But catch that the expectation of prayer is there. You must not be like the hypocrites, because they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by people. The word standing, and the way it says it right there, is like it has a time period kind of tied to it, right? To be standing up in front of everyone is saying that you're making a big show and a big production out of it, right? And the street here, that the emphasis there would be like a wide street. It would be a popular street. It would be a street where people would be, right? And you didn't pray on the street corners, right? But if you were a super strict, you know, religious type, Pharisaic type Jew, you had an afternoon prayer time. You were supposed to have an afternoon prayer time. So if you were really wanting people to see you, then you could make sure that you just happened to stroll right to the corner of the big wide street where there was a whole bunch of people right at the, oh man, it's afternoon prayer time. I have to stand here and pray in front of all you guys so you can see how close I am with God and how devoted I am to Him. That's what Jesus is implying here with these words. Our equivalent would kind of be like Wayne coming up here today. Right? Wayne comes up here today, tells a funny story like he generally tends to do, and then prays for us. Great. That's awesome. There's nothing wrong with public prayer. There's nothing wrong with, not only is there nothing wrong with it, it's needed. It's necessary. Communal prayer together is a great thing. But if that is the only time Wayne prays, then that's a problem. That's what Jesus is saying. Right? We don't want to come up here as leaders in the church and pray. I don't want to stand here and pray where we all can hear it, but I'm not spending time in communion with God myself one-on-one. Standing here praying but not doing that means I want you to think that I'm really close to God and I'm really good at this prayer thing. And Jesus is saying, not so big on that. He says, but when you pray, again, the same word, the same contrast, hypocrites, but when you do it, my people, you, right? That emphatic you gets their attention. He says, when you do it, go into your private room, shut your door, and pray to the Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. This word here is like an inner room. Closet would be our kind of equivalent, right? It's a storeroom inside the house. It's probably a windowless room. So if you're in there doing this, nobody could possibly see you. It's possibly, we don't know for sure, but sometimes, many times, this was the only lockable door in the house. So Jesus is saying, go into the room in the center of the house with no windows, with the door that you can actually lock so that you can spend one-on-one time with the Father in prayer. Do it right. Biblical prayer is an act of faith. It's expressing our dependence on God. Repetition and praying for the big things that we're trying to do is manipulation of people, and it's trying to manipulate God. The kingdom servant wants to spend time with the king, right? The disciple, he wants to commune with the Father. The son and the daughter of God wants to commune. He wants to spend time with his Father. If you don't want time with God, then you don't want heaven. Why would God bring you to heaven if you don't want to spend time with Him? It's a relationship. It's an important part of the relationship. And then on this specific aspect, He doesn't stop with the hypocrites. He expands, right? He keeps going. He says, but when you pray, don't babble like the idolaters. So now we're past the Pharisees and the scribes, the hypocrites. Now we're going on to the non-believers, the pagans, the Gentiles, however your translation may say it. Don't babble like the idolaters. Since they imagine they'll be heard for their many words, don't be like them, because your Father knows the things you need before you ask Him. And we say this sometimes. I heard that if God already knows what I need, then why do I even need to say it? Because you're not informing God of what you need. You're spending time with Him so that He can give you what you need, which ultimately is a changed heart and a heart that longs and desires after Him. Right? So what we can't do is try to manipulate God into compliance. And sometimes that's what we do, right? I need my prayer warriors. Now, if you've said this recently, I'm not thinking of you, okay? This is just proverbially. There's nothing wrong with saying this. I'm talking about saying these types of things with the wrong heart, from the wrong motivation. I need my prayer warriors to really be praying, right? Because if we get enough people praying and they pray the right way with the right words and we talk about it enough, then somehow God is obligated to do whatever it is we're praying about. That's just not true. That's just not true. But we should get our prayer warriors together and we should pray about it. But we should be doing that with a desire to know what to do for each other and to spend time with God so that he can give us that power, that information, that whatever it is, that desire inside of us to do whatever it is. But don't think that if you're at 99 prayer warriors, then the person you're praying for that has cancer isn't going to get healed. But if you get to 100, well, then that's the magic number. Once you get to 100, then now God has to, because we've got so many people praying about it. It's that desire, the motivation behind it. We can't manipulate God into compliance, into our will. He desires for us to be compliant with his will, and his will is best. Now, this story coming from the Old Testament is one of my favorites. Some of you know this, right? Probably because there's a little bit of sarcasm in there. Fault on me, right? Character flaw in your pastor. I like sarcasm. I think it's hilarious. 1 Kings chapter 18. This is when Elijah is on Mount Carmel, and there's a battle of the gods taking place, and the prophets of Baal, they have to make their bull be consumed by fire. And then Elijah says he'll make the real God consume the bull by fire. He'll ask God to do that. And there's a big showdown, right? And so the bull is set, the altar's set, and the people are all around, and everything's about to happen. And then and Elijah says, all right, you guys go first. Pray to your God, and let's see what happens. 1 Kings chapter 18, the last half of verse 26 says this. Then they, the prophets of Baal, called on the name of Baal from morning till noon. Talking about the repetition here. Baal, answer us! Baal, answer us! Baal, answer us! They shouted. But there was no response. No one answered. And they danced around the altar they had made. Just picture this scene. Picture the scene. And at noon, Elijah began to taunt them. Shout louder! Shout louder, Baal, hello. Surely he is a god. Perhaps he's in deep thought, right? Maybe he's busy or he's traveling. You got to get his attention. Maybe he is sleeping and needs to be awakened. So they shouted louder and they slashed themselves with swords and spears, as was their custom, until their blood flowed. Midday passed, and they continued their frantic prophesying until the time for the evening sacrifice. But there was no response. No one answered. No one paid attention, because they're praying to something that isn't real. But they sure were putting the energy into it. Don't do that, Jesus says. Don't be like that. He says, therefore, do it like this. You should pray like this. Father in heaven, your name be honored as holy. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not bring us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. He's not forbidding public prayer. There's nothing wrong with public prayer, but only public prayer and never private prayer is a problem. He's saying, look, this is God we're talking about. I just clicked on the wrong slide again. What did I do? Where'd it go? There we go. Thumb spasm. He's saying, look, just have a simple conversation. Just be real. When you pray to God, honor him for the honor he deserves. Talk about your needs, right? Honor God. Talk about your needs. Desire the power to forgive. Ask for the power to forgive for that unforgivable thing that's been done to you, right? Because God has forgiven unforgivable things that you have done. Right? Desire the power to forgive out of the recognition of your need for forgiveness. Pray against evil. Pray against all these things. Pray for more than just a good day. Many of you have heard me say that so many times, you're probably tired of hearing me say that. Like, if that's the extent of our prayers, they should be bigger than that. I don't know, maybe pray for a miracle, like someone coming to salvation, coming to repentance and placing their faith in Jesus. Pray for the things that matter. Just make it simple. It's not a magic formula. And then he doubles down on the forgiveness. For if you forgive people their wrongdoing, your heavenly Father will forgive you as well. But if you don't forgive people, your Father will not forgive your wrongdoing. He doubles down on that idea that our prayer, a lot of it should be about the power and the desire to forgive each other. Because without forgiveness, relationships are impossible. Say that one more time. Without forgiveness, relationships are impossible. We have to be able to forgive in order to have relationships with each other, because we're going to mess it up. We're going to mess it up. Then the last thing he finishes with, when you fast. Notice again, what's not in there? Sorry about that one. Not if you fast, when you fast. Now, it's not commanded. I'm going to put that on the front end. It's not commanded that we have to fast. But this one specifically was like the super, super thing for the Pharisees. They fasted twice a week, and they let you know about it. And if you weren't fasting twice a week, well, you just weren't really a very good Jew. You weren't doing the things the way that you should be doing. He says, when you do it, don't be like the hypocrites. Don't be sad-faced. They walk around all, poor me, I'm fasting, I'm so pious. I'm such a devoted follower of God. They want to make it so obvious to people that they're fasting. Now, I'll be honest with you, you ain't ever fasted. You don't know how hard that is to not do. I'm just telling you. Fast for 24 hours. Go from 6 p.m. to the next 6 p.m. and tell me how hard it is to not go, I'm fasting. I'm so hungry. I'm telling you. The first time I did a 24-hour fast, I thought about the fact that Jesus fasted for 40 days, and I'm like, gotta be God. Gotta be God. You can fast for 40 days. I'm just telling you, that's unbelievable. He says, don't be like that. And again, I assure you, I tell you the truth, listen, they get their reward. How you say, oh, wow, you're so special for fasting so much, that's what they get. That's it. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face so that you don't show your fasting to people, but your Father who is in secret and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Sum this up real quick so we don't go too long today. The main thing he's saying here is just take great care when you're making a sacrifice like fasting in order to spend time with God. That's the point of fasting, by the way, is to spend more time in prayer, to seek God, to have more time and focus to seek God. Whatever you could fast from, that's the point of prayer, of fasting. Whenever you do that, just try to act as normally as possible. And that's a difficult, difficult thing to do, because that sin thing in you is going to want to shout to the world how much you're sacrificing for God. I challenge you to try it and see if I'm lying to you. It's hard. For once, I'll give a little sympathy to the Pharisees. It's hard not to do that. Right? So the point is not that there's a specific way to fast. The point is, if you decide to do that, to set aside time to get closer to God, just be as normal about your rest of your daily living as you can, to draw attention not to yourself at all, but just trust God that He will reward you how He sees fit. Let's sum it up real quick. Jesus says that real worship, what He wants from us, is for us to just be sincere. Be sincere. Be honest, transparent, and caring. That's how we define sincere here. Be honest, transparent, and caring in what you do. Be sincere in your mercy or your almsgiving. We could extend it past just finances. Be sincere in your mercy, your prayers, and your sacrifices. Fasting is a sacrifice. There's more than just that. Be sincere in your mercy, your prayers, and your sacrifices. Don't be a hypocrite. And specifically in our worship, the whole point of worship, any act of worship, is to honor God, not to be recognized by people. And if you'll be honest with yourself and you'll look in a mirror, your wretchedness, your sin will come out when you think of worship this way. And you think of how much you desire to be recognized by people for what you do for God. That's normal, but normal doesn't mean right. God says, pray to me for the ability to not do that. Pray to me for the power to worship me for real, regardless, as if anyone ever, ever knows. True worship is seeking seeking to honor God, whether people know it or not. Fake worship is showing how you honor God so you can be honored by people. And God despises that with a passion. So I'll finish with this. Imagine this with me. We'll be done. Imagine with me if this church, or any church for that matter, but specifically this church, this group of assembled people, imagine if we all sought genuine sincerity in our worship, in all of our acts of worship, when we sing together, when we give, when we pray, if we fast, sacrifice, however you want to put it. We sought to honor God and only honor God, whether anybody knew about it ever at all, and trusted that His reward for that is much greater than anything man could ever bestow on you. What would that church look like? And what would that church accomplish? Let those questions just ring in our heads as we finish in prayer. God, thank you for Jesus, for the price that was paid for us on the cross so that we could have a relationship with you, God. We could begin it now and that we could continue it forever. Thank you for eternal life. Thank you for forgiveness of sins. Thank you that you are the great forgiver. Lord, give us the desire to forgive. Give us the desire to be merciful. Give us the desire to want what is you and to want the things of you and to want to obey you, Lord, and give us the power to do that as well, God. Give us the heart to want to honor you and not be worried about the worldly honor we get for anything good that we do, because anything good we do comes from you and was set into motion by you from eternity past. Lord, may we trust in you for all things we need, God. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. Last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak, would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. In the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, and all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Finding myself
There we are. All right. Hey, one thing that has come up over and over, Grant did a phenomenal job last night, and he mentioned, the way he put it, he said, God doesn't call us to be perfect. He calls us to be obedient. And then Daniel basically said the same thing in just a little bit different words. It said, perfection is unattainable, so the standard is a surrendered heart. So I just want to encourage you, if you are, whether it's giving your life over in salvation or something that God is calling you to do, an area of service or someone you should be speaking with, someone you should be witnessing with to, surrender is what God asks of you. He doesn't ask you to go and be able to sing perfectly or to have the perfect words to say to someone, any of that, or to have your life right before you surrender it to him. He just wants your surrender. So I just want to say that. Also, we are celebrating 2 years with our pastor. And so we are extremely, extremely thankful for Daniel. I've got a few cards. I thought you deserved three, so I got you three. But we've also got some more. If you've got something else, go ahead. And Summer Ward, I told her you didn't like Reese's, but she said to hand it to you and then you could hand it back to me. So, all right, so we love you, we're thankful for you, and oh, we got more for
Ryland.
Of course, Ryland. All right, so now we'll move on, we'll go.
Awesome. Thank you very much. It's an honor to be your pastor, and serving with you is an unbelievable privilege, so I appreciate it. Let's finish with the Great Commission. Then Jesus came near and said to them, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you, and remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." Amen.